We've got a lot to cover. We're going to be continuing through Revelation. We're at chapter 17. And so that's our chapter text for today. And I want to be sure and try to cover it and get through it. And let's begin with a word of prayer. Lord, we want to thank you that you've given us your word that is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. And we're excited because we know that you're the living word. We know that the word is living. And we know, Lord, that we can rely upon your counsel and not have to second guess those things as if it's the philosophy of the world, but it comes from you. So we trust you, we trust your word, and help us to learn it, to respond according to your will, to bring you glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So, Revelation chapter 17, and the title is A Judgment Chronicle. And the reason I entitled it that way is that I had mentioned that the chapters in the book of Revelation are not always chronological. And so, like here in these next two chapters, in chapter 17 and 18, we have, I kind of look back at what takes place in judgment. Chapter 16 was the bowl judgments. We looked at that, and they were poured out as a final judgment on the world. And then chronologically, the next event would be chapter 19, and that would be the return of Jesus Christ, the second coming of Christ. And so that would then pick up the sequence of the book. And so sandwiched between the sequence is chapters 17 and 18. And so in the bowl judgments, we see that Babylon is destroyed. We saw that back in 16, verse 19. Now, chapter 17 backs up, moves to a bird's eye view, from a bird's eye view to a close up, and shows us the destruction that takes place not only in Babylon, but in the religious system. So, chapter 17 deals with that, focuses on that, the destruction of Babylon and the religious system. And then when we get to chapter 18, it's going to focus on the destruction of the economic and the political systems of the world. And so before moving on, I want to mention that the final bowl judgments of chapter 16 are heaven-sent. Just a reminder, we saw that in chapter 16, verse 1. So God alone is in the temple. It's a beautiful picture. And from the temple, he's there, and no one could enter the temple at this time. We see that in chapter 15, verse 8. And so I find that a very interesting detail. I had to keep pondering that. That God alone, during the pouring out of the bowl judgment, is alone in the temple. And I would say, at this point, no matter how many pray, or how much the devil tries, no one will interfere. There will be no earthly origin concerning these judgments. They are from God completely and totally. And it's interesting because there is that truth as we, you know, look at 1 John in chapter 5, verse 16. It talks about, chapter 5, verse 16, there it is. If anyone sees his brother sinning a sin which does not lead to death, he will ask and he will give him life. For those who commit sin, not leading to death, there is a sin leading to death. I do not say that he should pray about that. And I thought, wow, that's a scripture we really can't get into. but it's regarding the principle that God has already determined, something God has already determined. So there's no sense praying about what God has already determined. Now, of course, the problem with that is we're not always sure what that is, and so we pray. But it's the idea that no matter how many prayers go up, what God does is not going to be influenced, not going to be changed. And so at this time, no influencing, no altering, no slowing down this grand finale of judgments according to God's will, the bowl judgments. Where early on, when you think about the seal judgments and the trumpet judgments, where the devil was allowed to manipulate, where man influenced, were instrumental regarding the judgments. They manipulated, they influenced, they caused things to happen, many of the things that we see. That could have been man's doing. And we look at that as different. But now in the bowl judgments described here, that's not going to be the case. God's moving forward and nothing's going to interrupt that final say of what God brings down. And so, having said that, you look at chapter 17 now, verse 1. Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came and talked with me, saying to me, "Come, I will show you the judgment of the great harlot who sits on many waters, with whom the kings of the earth committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth were made drunk with the wine of her fornication." And so this snapshot shows us that there's a great harlot. Now, the King James uses the word whore. And what this symbolizes is that the religious system, and it speaks of the selling of its goods like a whore. And it speaks of betrayal, it speaks of deception, and it speaks of, you know, all of the above regarding treachery. And so this treachery, of course, is against God and all humanity. And so deception leads the way because it always does, deception of false religion and the devil. Remember, even way back in the garden when he deceived Eve and then Adam jumped on board. And so you have that deception from the very beginning. The Bible speaks of the devil. He comes as an angel of light. And so if you're not hearing from the Spirit, an angel of light can be very deceptive. You could look and go, wow, you know, this is really good. But in 2 Corinthians 11, Paul reminds us, "For such are the false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for Satan himself transforms himself into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also transform themselves into ministers of righteousness, whose end will be according to their works." And so this has been the way of the devil all along. And so now in this great tribulation seen through the Antichrist and the false prophet, the dragon, it's all about deception. And so he's out there deceiving the Antichrist. Remember, back in Revelation chapter 6, he comes first initially on a white horse to deceive as being the man of peace. And so this is the great harlot who sits on many waters. That would be defined in verse 15, meaning many nations. But there's the kings of the earth that are committed fornication, and they inhabit the inhabitants of the earth, made drunk. You notice, made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So they join in and they're drunk, kind of like alcohol would work against the physical body, kind of takes over the senses. So you have now the devil through the Antichrist and through the false prophet, controlling the spiritual man, those who do not have God's Spirit. And that's where the vacuum is for the devil to come in and to deceive. Jesus said in John 14, 17, "The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you." So there's a difference there. And so they will be deceived. They will be manipulated. And they will be made drunk, is how it's worded. I like the way one commentator put it this way. Karl Marx was right when he called religion the opiate of the masses. He discovered the truth that man is incurably driven to worship something somewhere. If humans do not bow before the holy and true God, then they will devise their own method, their own system, their own God, and they will worship their own creation. While the coming world religious system in some ways resembles Christianity, John calls it Babylon the Great, a monstrosity economical combination or ecumenical combination of everything that people consider spiritual, and the world will buy into it, hook, line, and sinker, mostly sinker. And that's not hard to see. But it's the state of mankind apart from God. And the harlot's sin, notice, is fornication. In the Bible, harlotry consistently stands for idolatry. And you know, even in Jeremiah 3:6, it says, "The Lord said also to me in the days of Josiah the king, have you seen what backsliding Israel has done? She has gone up on every high mountain and on every green tree, and there played the harlot," describing there the worshiping of idols that are built. So in Jeremiah 3:9 it says, "And so it came to pass through her casual harlotry that she defiled the land and committed adultery with stones and trees." So rather than worshiping the living God, they made wooden idols and stone idols and worshiped them. But I find it interesting because when the reference is made of the children of Israel, it says they committed adultery. Well, see, the world cannot commit adultery. They commit fornication. Because in order to commit adultery, you have to once belonged to the Lord. And the world never has belonged to the world. So they commit fornication. And so in verse 3, it says, "So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sitting on a scarlet beast, which was full of names of blasphemy, having 7 heads and 10 horns. The woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet and adorned with gold and precious stones and pearls, having in her hand a golden cup full of abominations and the filthiness of her fornication. And on her forehead a name was written, Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and of the abominations of the earth. I saw the woman drunk with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I marveled with great amazement." So this scene is stunning. This woman, the corrupted religious system, is sitting on the beast, which would be the Antichrist. So you notice that this religious system forges some sort of alliance with the beast. And so this beast, for a time, is supporting this whole religious system. Of course, those that are in a position to rule or to have power in history has wanted the religious system to support them as long as it was for their benefit. And so we see that described there, which was full of the beast, which was full of blasphemy. And notice, having seven heads and 10 horns. So that really describes a person and a place of power. And so this woman, verse 4, notice, was a rich religious system. And so there was many that was enriched to be part of this system. And so in a sense, they were continuing with that. Remember that in us, in human beings, God created a God-shaped void that could only be filled by Him. And people will go in any which direction to say, to try and fill that void, that need in their life to be satisfied, but only God can fill it. But they go here and they go there. They gain riches. They do whatever. They worship riches, in this case, would be. And I know Don Fetter of the Boston Herald said, as a significant portion of the population drifts away from traditional religion, Americans look for comfort from beyond the stars. When a people has that kind of persuasive mentality that something wise and powerful and superior is out there, whether it in the form of demons or space aliens or avatars or what have you, then the earth becomes ripe for deception. And I would say that the earth is ripe for deception. There's a longing, and a lot of us wrapped around intellect. We're so smart, we have it all figured out. You know, we've got computers and we've got all this stuff, and you know, and you can take that mentality even back to the 60s. You know, when people were searching for peace and love. What happens? They were searching for peace and love in all the wrong places and end up with drugs and broken relationships and destroyed lives and death. Why? You would think, well, isn't that a good thing to search for peace and love? Well, not if it's in the wrong places. And so that God-shaped boy, there's plenty to jump on board for the false religion. Well, yeah, hey, we're searching for God. You know, we're loving God. We're caring about God. And there's a time in judgment when Jesus says, hey, you say you've done it in my name. I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers from iniquity. You workers of iniquity. I never knew you. In other words, they were never born again. But they're very religious, coming even in the name of Jesus. So there's going to be this false religion. And you notice in verse 5, and on her forehead, a name. So I'm thinking, okay, so here's this religious system on its forehead. And so I had to think, well, it means that it's not secret. It's in the forefront. Sort of like a mission statement would be. You know, just written right across their forehead. This is what we stand for. This is our mission statement. And what is it? Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots, of the abomination of the earth. So don't be deceived. What does that mean? Well, there's a single origin, source, mother, singular. So they birthed the many religions that are out there, that are all accepting, sort of all in the family of false religions. We're all from the same source, one origin, all related, which will have some representation of Christianity, corrupted. That should not surprise us. You can see it today. Many that are out there just looking to make money and to be rich and proclaiming Christianity, then even in the name of Jesus. And, you know, that Paul addressed when he wrote in 1 Timothy 4:1, now the Spirit expressly says that in the latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons. So people that once believed correctly are now giving way to doctrines of demons. And that always feeds the flesh. The flesh is always willing to be fed, if you let it. You're supposed to be dying to self, not feeding the flesh. And so they get entrapped in that way. And then also in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 7 and 8, it says, "For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work, and he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way, and then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming." And so Paul in just one verse says, hey, the Antichrist is going to come, and then Jesus is going to destroy him. In a nutshell, that's what's going to happen. And so we see that in verse 6, you see, "I saw the woman drunk with the blood of the saints." When I read that, I remembered thinking of how the Eskimos would hunt for wolves. You might have heard this before. They'll take a block of blood, frozen blood, and in the middle of that, they would have razor blades. And they would set that block of blood out on the frozen tundra, and the wolves would find it and start licking at it. And as they're licking and licking, they get to the razor blades, and then pretty soon they start cutting their tongue, and then they become even more ravenous and drinking their own blood. And then eventually they bleed to death, and that's the end. They got their wolf, their fur to stay warm. And they're drunk in the blood of the saints. It's like that, ravenous. But it ends up being death and judgment. They're the wolves. They're out there. Scary. And then John looks at that and I marveled with great amazement. How could this be? How could this take place? This is mind-blowing, in my words. Poets should use that more. Mind-blowing. To me, that has so much meaning. But this is just politics as usual. This is just the way of the world. You know, I say, you know, it's crazy too, but I was reading where this one writer wrote it this way. In fact, we see a conditioning occurring right now throughout the world and even in America toward the elimination of people. Abortion is legal in every state, in many cases funded and sanctioned by the government. The key idea behind this is that a mother can choose to eliminate her unwanted fetus. The next logical step, euthanasia, and has already started taking root. If it's legal to eliminate an unwanted fetus, then what about unwanted adults? Those who are sick or elderly or terminally ill. State of Oregon already has a law on the books that permits assisted suicide for terminally ill patients. Society is methodologically paving the way to remove any human life deemed unwanted, unviable, or unproductive. With that sort of mindset in place, it will be no great step for the Antichrist to move toward eliminating believers in Christ. After all, they will refuse to cooperate with the state-sanctioned religious system and will insist instead on preaching about Jesus. The beast's answer, remove them. The world would be better off without them. We're seeing that mentality developing and growing even now. Even now. It'll be a breeze for him. It's a mindset. And then when I read, well, the Antichrist says, just remove them. Well, how about from Facebook? How about from YouTube? Just remove them. Silence them. Just remove them. And so John writes in verse 6, I'm amazed at this. And how many of us would say, I marvel at this. I'm amazed at what I'm watching. This is crazy, what I see. The thinking, there's no common sense involved here. How could people that are so smart do what they're doing? I don't get it, you know. I mean, can we all jump on ships and find a country that still needs to be discovered or something? I mean, I don't know. You know, I say that facetiously. I know some of you think, well, that might be Texas. You know, I would disagree, but whatever. Cruise on over to Texas, right? Yeah. But But anyway, so he's amazed, and I love that. It just puts it out there. But the angel said to me, verse 7, why did you marvel? I will tell you the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carries her, which has the seven heads and the ten horns. And so I wonder why. Once again, the angel's going, what are you marveling about? Basically, I marvel at the conditions of the day. As I mentioned, I call them the twilight zone. Should it be like this? If you believe, like many of us do, we are witnessing the end times scenario. That's where we get comfort. The working out of God's plan, the staging of the global platform, I liken it to the acts of a play. When I was in sixth grade, I had a drama class, and I had stage fright. So the teacher tried to work with me. Well, if you're not involved, you're going to fail the class. So she put me behind the stage so that when the curtains close for the next act, everything starts getting set up. And then, of course, the curtains would open to the next scene. And also, when the curtains would close, they'd have some sort of advertisement that they would do a little skit while the people were waiting for the next scene to open. And so she says, and you have to be seen by people. And she knew that I couldn't, I was just freaked out about getting, you know, and but so she figured out a way for me to do it so she wouldn't have to compromise her standard of grade giving. I became a deodorant bottle. And they did. And I just had to stand there while they gave the advertisement for how good the deodorant worked. So I passed the test. But like that, you know, sometimes we're watching the skit. Other times we're watching the next act. But sooner or later, it's the final act and the end and the final curtain call. It all stacking up. Peter writes, why should we be surprised? Very familiar verse, 1 Peter 4:12 and 13. Beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you as though some strange thing happened to you, but rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. So that's what we look forward to. Don't be shocked. Why should you be shocked that, you know, there's fiery trials? Why should you be shocked that the world hates you? They're diplomatic about it, or have been. That's going to change. It's changed, you know, through history over and over again. And so don't be so shocked that it's going to be that way. And so we have verse 8, the beast that you saw was and is not and will ascend out of the bottomless pit and go to perdition, and those who dwell on the earth will marvel, whose names are not written in the book of life from the foundations of the world. Then you see the beast that was and is and is not and yet is. Okay, so we know from chapter 16 that the beast is destroyed and sent to perdition in the final judgment. But when you look back at, you know, Revelation chapters 1 through 3, it really describes the beast as having, the Antichrist having a mortal head wound, and then as if he comes back to life. And then there's a transition that takes place after that where the people worship the dragon. They give, you know, that worship to the dragon and the Antichrist. So there's a transition that's spoken of there. And I think that Revelation 13, the first four verses, really kind of helps explain that. Here is the mind which has wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sits. And so the headquarters, if you will, of the church. Now, nobody can really be dogmatic about where the church might have headquarters different than where the Antichrist would have headquarters, but there's definitely two places. Now, I read this that sums it up, I thought, pretty good. The seven heads or the seven mountains is possibly Rome, known as the city of seven hills, but it doesn't say seven mountains, so I'm just bringing that to your attention. Or it could be seven nations or seven seats of power, as a mountain often represents a seat of power in the Bible. So they could also represent the entire world, since seven is the number of completion and applied that way throughout the book of Revelation. That's what the number seven has applied. And if it is Rome, her influence is worldwide. What we know for certain is that she has great authority, influence. Those alive during that time will know this well. We'll see it well. We'll understand it well. And so here this woman sits, verses 10 and 11. There are also seven kings. Five have fallen. One is, and the other has not yet come. And when he comes, he must continue a short time. So there'll be a transfer of power when the new king reigns. The beast that was and is not is himself also the eighth, and is of the seventh, and is going to perdition. Once again, can't be dogmatic, but my pastor, Chuck Smith, who really believed that this was referring to the false church that would be set up in Rome, he puts it this way. When John was writing, the sixth king was on the throne of the Roman Empire. Five had died, and one was yet to come. The beast will be one of the seven. Caesar Nero was the fifth emperor of Rome and was called the beast by the early church. After he rejected Paul, the apostle's witness, his actions were those of a demon-possessed man. In my opinion, the demon who possessed Nero will possess the Antichrist. And so, you know, he explains it that way. But once again, we know that this is what's going to take place. It's a transition of power. It's going to end up being the Satan himself, and in the Antichrist that will be overpowered by Jesus. Verse 12, then, 10 horns, which you saw are 10 kings who have received no kingdom as yet, but they received authority for 1 hour as kings with the beast. Now, Daniel chapter 7 explains this part of Revelation 17 very well. It's huge. I recommend that you read Daniel chapter 7 as it is an end times prophecy. And it clearly, way back then, describes the exact same thing that John's describing now that's going to take place in the great tribulation. So that's your homework. These are of one mind, and they will give their power and authority to the beast. So there's that total global allegiance to these 10 kings that people believe are going to make up that rule on planet Earth. They call it the European community, actually. So there's this allegiance. And one mind, power, and give their power and authority to the beast. So they come on board with the beast. These will make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and those who are with him are called chosen and faithful. And so those that are with him, we're coming back with the Lord when he comes back. It tells us that in 1 Thessalonians 4, 16 through 18, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. And so when the Lord comes back, we're coming back with him. And then it tells us in verse 15 and 16, then he said to me, the waters which you saw where the harlot sits are peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues. So that's where what the water represents, that interpretation of verse 1 there. And the 10 horns which you saw on the beast, these will These will hate the harlot. So remember, these kings joined one mind with the beast. They hate the harlot, right? The corrupted religious system. And make her desolate and naked, eat her flesh, and burn her with fire. So it implodes. They turn on the corrupt system. And of course, in other words, they've used the corrupt system as long as they need to. Now they want the power that system would wield as well. And so like a cat would play with a mouse, you know, at that point. Okay, we're done playing, and then they just eat the mouse. You've probably seen that before. And I think that this would really symbolize the middle of the tribulation when in Daniel chapter 9, it tells us that in the middle of this peace agreement that the Antichrist would make with Israel, the 7 year, right in the middle, he breaks that treaty. Now, Israel would be in that system of a false, corrupt religious system. But it's at that point when the Antichrist comes in there into the temple, proclaims himself to be God, their eyes are opened, and many of Israel are saved at that point in time when God does a great work in Israel. But it'll take that moment. And at that same time, of course, the rest of that whole religious system is taken over. And so then in verse 17, for God has put it into their hearts to fulfill his purpose, to be of one mind, and to give their kingdom to the beast till the words of God are fulfilled. So it's in God's timing and God's doing. This is it. Everything's moving forward. Just like he hardened the heart of Pharaoh in Egypt when it was time for God's people to be delivered. It was done. No more vacillating on the part of Pharaoh anymore. His heart was hard as it was. And then the woman whom you saw is that great city which reigns over the kings of the earth. And so that false church had the power stripped away at that point. And so next week we get into again the judgment against the economics and the political system of Babylon, that worldly system that was entrenched during the Great Tribulation. So, shall we stand together? If you need prayer today, come forward here. There'll be somebody here to pray with you. And then don't forget about that sign-up sheet for Mary if you want to do that. And then also there's some Calvary Chapel magazines that we keep forgetting to pass out that are on the table over there. So great articles. Lord, thank you for this new day that you've given to us. A reminder, it's never been before. It will never be again. Help us take full advantage with hearts of worship towards you, that we would not be distracted by all that's happening around us, that we wouldn't be shocked, surprised, how could this be? But we would only be more excited about seeing things set up according to your plan, knowing, Lord, that you're with us, as your word tells us, you'll never leave us or forsake us. We want to thank you for the promises. I pray if any here do not have that confidence, Lord, that today they'd make that decision to trust in you, to follow you, to ask you for forgiveness of sins, because, Lord, you say to us in your word that if we confess our sins, that you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so, Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you there is no gray zone. You take us out of darkness and you put us in not low light, but your light, where we shine bright. So help us, Lord, to follow you and to encourage one another through these very difficult times. We thank you for your faithfulness. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.